someday.
Hey there. Michael and I are just hanging out here dancing to some music. And Michael, you know what, which musician this is? Yeah, that's right. It's Louis Armstrong. You know what kind of music this is? That's right. It's jazz music. Now, here's a big question. Do you know where both jazz music and Louis Armstrong came from? Hey, that's right. New Orleans. So smart. What else do you know about New Orleans? Oh, you know, it's where people like to go to party. Yeah. Oh, Bourbon Street. You've heard of Bourbon Street. Yeah, you must have learned about that from your mom. Okay. Well, hey, did you know that Bourbon Street wasn't actually named after a liquor, but rather after the French monarchy? Yeah. So, tell you what, since you're so interested in New Orleans and New Orleans culture, what do you say we teach the Euro Bears a little something about the founding of New Orleans? It all has to do with a story about John Law and the Mississippi Bubble of 1720. Yay! Hey there, Euro Bears. Welcome to this video on John Law, the Mississippi Bubble, and the Mississippi Company. All right, there's a lot in here on the Dutch, too. Let's learn something. First, I would like to cite my source here. I had personally never even heard of John Law and the Mississippi Bubble until a few years ago, I guess more like 10 years ago now, when I read this book, The Ascent of Money by Niall Ferguson. Ferguson is an Irish economist who teaches at Oxford, Harvard, and Stanford. Yes, he's one of those super dons who can make everyone else in the room feel dumb. After this book was released, he made a multi-part documentary for PBS by the same name. And the book was released in 2008 and the documentary in 2009. And this was a time when the United States of America and really the entire world was suffering from the beginnings of a terrible global economic crisis. And Ferguson used his documentary on the history of money to help explain what was happening at that time. It's a great series, and I'm including a link to his episode on John Law and the Mississippi Bubble in the description of this YouTube video. So if you'd like to learn a little more about this topic from one of the best economic historians of our time, you should click on it and watch it. All right, so now here's my telling of this story. John Law was a Scotsman. He was born in 1671 and he grew up in the Scottish capital of Edinburgh. He grew up the son of a banker and developed a fondness for both mathematics and gambling. Math and gambling, what perfect interest for the man who concocted perhaps the greatest financial scam in European history. In 1694, he was living in London and he was sleeping with a woman by the name of Elizabeth Villiers, who also happened to be the mistress of King William III and the girlfriend of several other men. When one of Elizabeth's other lovers grew jealous and challenged John Law to a duel, John Law killed him and fled the country, and he went to the Netherlands. The Netherlands were the perfect place for a banker and gambler on the run from the law to hide out. Here, during the waning of the Dutch Golden Age, John Law learned firsthand about those great Dutch investors, investment banking, and the stock market. So why don't we pause here from the story of John Law and review the story of the Dutch. A little over 100 years before John Law set foot in Amsterdam, the Dutch had developed the joint stock company. The Dutch had a history of free trade going all the way back to the 1300s and the development of the Hanseatic League. That relative economic freedom allowed them to develop a rather clever way of making money, the limited liability joint stock company. And here's how it worked. Imagine if you wanted to trade with the Chinese on the other side of the earth. This would be a rather risky endeavor for just one wealthy individual or even the government. If you sent a boat out to the other side of the world to buy Chinese silk and porcelain in an attempt to bring it back to Europe and sell it and make a profit, there was so much that could go wrong. There could be bad weather, pirates, mutiny, or unwilling Chinese sellers. This venture would simply be too risky for one individual. But the Dutch reasoned, What if the liability of the trip was simply divided up among multiple people? This was the beginnings of the first companies and the first investment bankers. Instead of just one investor in a high-risk, high-reward venture, many people would invest and become shareholders in the venture. If the ship did get lost or sunk or something bad happened, you'd still lose your money, but you would not be individually wiped out. But then if the gamble paid off and the ship made it back to port and was actually able to sell its exotic Chinese wares to very excited buyers, then you'd make money, lots and lots of money. Dutch companies were created to help finance these trades, and individuals could invest in the companies. The world's first stock market was born on the streets of Amsterdam. In 1602, the government of the Netherlands established the Dutch East India Company. This government-run company took all of the competing Dutch companies under their control, establishing a government-run monopoly. But since all the trade was now happening under the government auspices, the traders were empowered to sign treaties with other countries. And the government provided military defense to these trade ships. Allow me to say this again. Because all of the trade was now happening under the government, the traders, the companies, were empowered to sign peace treaties with other countries. And the government also provided military defense to these trade ships. Okay, so imagine if this happened today. Imagine if you took a company like Walmart, and Walmart was empowered by the United States government to establish peace treaties with other countries at their will, and if the United States government provided military defense to the entire Walmart shipping fleet. So imagine if that happened today. It's exactly what the Dutch were doing starting in the early 1600s. Clearly, the Netherlands were more of a company than a country. And it worked. They made boatloads of money. Haha, boatloads of money. Now, it's important to note that in their quest to trade and make a lot of money, the Dutch did some truly despicable things. Most significantly, they traded human beings. The very first slaves brought to the American colonies arrived in Virginia in the year 1619, and they were brought on Dutch ships. So the egalitarian Dutch Calvinist, who would never have permitted slavery in their own homes in the Netherlands, this still didn't stop them from profiteering on the slave trade abroad. Now, if you're thinking, wow, the Dutch, the Calvinists, what religious hypocrites. They didn't believe in slavery, but yet they weren't afraid to profit off of slavery. If you're thinking about their hypocrisy, well, just be aware that we Americans are very similar in this way. There are several American companies whose products we use and love that were probably made in factories in East Asia where the working conditions are deplorable and the workers are paid very poorly. It's pretty close to slavery today. Yet most of us today will tend to turn a blind eye to these things when they happen to happen very, very, very far away on the other side of the earth, and we enjoy these products, and those companies and our country as a whole experience positive economic growth. So in this way, we today in the 21st century are very similar to the Dutch. The United Provinces of the Netherlands became the wealthiest country per capita in Europe. Now, this is not the wealthiest country, period, but per capita, the average person was wealthy. They didn't have a king, but rather regional governors or stadtholders, a word you see here. The official religion of the Netherlands was the Dutch Reformed Church, which was Calvinist, and the Dutch clearly saw their wealth as a sign of God's blessing. But the Dutch were more concerned with good business than anything else, and they saw the value of embracing a multicultural society. Trading with a variety of countries forces one to adapt a multicultural ethic. It's hard to hate somebody when you both have the opportunity to profit from each other. So Jews and other minorities were welcome. Amsterdam became a very, very cosmopolitan society. It's worth mentioning here that Amsterdam has a very, very rich cultural heritage. In the 17th century, Baruch Spinoza emerged as one of the most important Jewish philosophers of all time. His family had fled persecution in Portugal, and his dad had lost a lot of money in poor investments in Amsterdam. Spinoza, his philosophy here, just in a really brief nutshell, Spinoza argued that there was no external God. There was no God in a separate universe or a separate reality that we might call heaven, but that rather everything in the universe was of God's making, so God was both everywhere and nowhere. his philosophy was so radical that he found that both Jews and Christians rejected him and his ideas, and he lived and died a rather lonely man. It's also worth mentioning that Amsterdam became the home of Anne Frank's family when they fled Nazi Germany in the middle of the 20th century. She and her family famously hid in an annex from 1942 through their capture in 1944. Amsterdam has a very, very rich cultural and specifically Jewish cultural history. All of the wealth and cosmopolitan qualities of the Dutch Golden Age is reflected in the art of two of its most important painters, Rembrandt and Vermeer, both 17th century guys. Rembrandt grew famous by painting portraits of wealthy merchants in Amsterdam. His paintings are very, very nuanced in how he tried to balance both Calvinist religiosity and extreme wealth. So you have paintings like this one that you see here that show a kindly man, the head of an investment company. And this man has kind, sympathetic eyes, and you think, wow, what a nice guy, very kind looking. But at the same time, he's wearing a very expensive fur coat and he's holding a banknote. You also know that this man is very important, a hardworking Calvinist businessman, maybe somebody to admire and perhaps fear. This is the balance that Rembrandt crafted, extreme wealth and a religious conscience. Both of these things are oh so very Dutch. And the other great Dutch painter of the age was Vermeer. So this is the civilization. Let me say something a little bit more about Vermeer here. I want to talk about a few of his paintings that we're looking at. So check out this particular painting here, which is on the left that Vermeer did. Notice that it's in a small room and there is a woman. Her head is covered because that's a Calvinist thing to do. Women, you would hide your hair from men because your hair is a beautiful part of you, and you know you don't want to arouse the man too much with your hair, so you cover up your head. So you see the shadow of the guy right there. He's got a big hat on, and the hat is actually a very popular fur hat that came out of Canada at the time. And so you've got a man who probably is a trader. He's probably worked for the Dutch East India Company or maybe the Dutch West India Company if he's going to Canada. And he's got some nice clothes on. And the woman is clearly enraptured with whatever the man is talking about. On the background there, you also have a map of the world. And so we've got, all these elements of trade that we see here in this particular painting. Now, look at this next painting. Sort of similar to the first. We've got a woman, only this time her hair is down and she's reading a letter. She's facing out of the window. And in front of her, if you look down, there's a nice carpeting that you see there. That is an oriental carpeting. You also see blue Chinese porcelain and spilling fruit that's coming out of the bowl, the porcelain bowl. And so a lot of people interpret this as the follow-up to the previous painting where the woman now has, she's alone so she can expose her hair. And she's reading a letter from maybe the same man who is regaling her with stories of travel and trade from the previous image. A spilling bowl of fruit tends to be a symbol of erotic love. But you've also got Chinese porcelain and a oriental rug. So you've got these symbols of trade and of wealth in this image too. Here's another painting by Vermeer. Please notice that there's something very similar going on in all these paintings. We'll talk about this in a second. But here you also have the celebration of a scientist. You've got some scientific drawings on the wall. You've got a man who's touching the globe. He's maybe doing something academic in a book in front of him, which is also similar to this one. So once again, you've got a globe above. You've got a man with a compass. He's maybe doing some, cartography or something. You also have the oriental rug. You have all this going on. So the one thing you notice in all these paintings is it seems to be a very, very similar room. You've got on the left-hand side of the painting the window with light coming in. One interpretation of this is the room is supposed to be the Netherlands. It's small, but it opens out into the rest of the world. And so some people think, oh, it's a nice metaphor for the Netherlands itself. But also maybe perhaps Vermeer was doing paintings in the same room And perhaps, well, we know he was using a particular contraption to help him with his paintings. This particular contraption is called the camera obscura. So check it out. Here's a nice little diagram of it. It lets light in, and it shows the image via reflection onto a pane of glass. And so, here's another image of it. Vermeer could do a basic sketch of whatever he was looking at, and then from that basic sketch, do a large canvas painting using that sketch as his foundation. So some people think, oh, Vermeer, you know, he's a cheater. He used this to cheat. But other people say, no, it still doesn't detract from his brilliance in painting. It just certainly explains why he painted the same room over and over again. For what it's worth, we have the word camera obscura here. The camera will develop out of the camera obscura. This will happen, the French will do this in the middle of the 19th century, and they'll do this by preparing a copper plate with a whole bunch of kind of really very dangerous chemicals and place it there where in this image you see the man drawing. And what will happen then is this copper plate with these chemicals will absorb the light and create a black and white image. And that is how the first photographs will be taken. One last image from Vermeer, the girl with the pearl earring, probably his most famous image, and probably his, well, I don't know, he painted a couple of naughty images, but this one sort of is naughty in a very nuanced way. So here you have a woman, and she's a maid, and her head is covered, but she's looking rather longingly at the observer of the painting, and then she's got this huge pearl earring, which is ostentatiously large. A girl of her social status would never be able to afford a pearl earring right like that. So most people interpret it as, well, this is also the girlfriend or the mistress of the man of the household, and he's paid her off with a big, beautiful pearl earring. There's a lot of mystery behind this painting. Some people think that it was Vermeer's girlfriend herself. So, but there you go. The Girl with the Pearl Earring from 1665, or about 1665, by Vermeer. All right. So back to the Dutch. So this was the civilization that the Dutch had created by the end of the 1600s. This was the land that Louis XIV jealously attacked and that the Dutch stadtholder William of Orange valiantly defended with international assistance. And this was the Netherlands that John Law stepped into in the 1690s when he was on the run from the law in Britain. And John Law, he liked what he saw in the Netherlands. He participated in investment banking. He studied how the Dutch system worked. And once he figured it all out, he dreamed up one of the biggest economic dreams in European history. What if he could single-handedly introduce this system to a new country? Into a kingdom. The Netherlands were so small. What if a big country with even more resources developed a trading company modeled after the Dutch East India Company? What if, instead of a stock market, all the trading were done through a national bank? John Law took this idea and crossed the southern border into France. John Law entered France in 1716, and his timing was perfect. Louis XIV had died the previous year. Louis XV was too young to rule, so the country was being ruled by the king's uncle, the Duke of Orléans. Louis XIV had left the country nearly bankrupt, and the Duke of Orléans was desperate to stabilize the French economy. The Duke of Orléans also loved gambling, just like John Law. Probably most anybody who spent a lot of time in Versailles developed a love for gambling. And when John Law arrived from the Netherlands, flaunting his wealth and introducing himself to the Duke with a plan for how to make both him and the country very, very rich, the Duke of Orléans was all ears. Here was the plan. First, John Law and the Duke of Orléans would create the first French national bank. This bank would begin issuing paper money instead of coins. The French had never used paper money before. John Law convinced the Duke of Orléans that paper money would simplify financial transactions. Plus, the government would have more control over the economy with paper money than it did with silver, gold, and copper coins. Second, the government would establish its own version of the Dutch East India Company. The original name of this company was the Company of the West, but by the pivotal year of 1720, it was known simply as the Mississippi Company. The company would be able to use paper money to invest, or I'm sorry, the people would be able to use paper money to invest in the Mississippi Company, and then stock certificates would be issued. And of course, stock certificates would also be made out of paper. And paper is very, very important here, which is why I'm accentuating it. After John Law and the Duke of Orléans established both the French National Bank and the Mississippi Company, the plan was unveiled to the French people, and it was very, very exciting. The French were promised that they too would soon become as wealthy as the Dutch. They would become investment bankers in a government-controlled company. The French had laid claim to the middle of North America. They named this huge tract of land after Louis XIV, and they named it Louisiana. The French were now going to sail into the interior of North America using that great waterway, the Mississippi River. They were going to set up multiple colonial forts where the French would trade with Native Americans. It was believed that these Native Americans had a lot of gold and silver and fur and other goods that they were willing to happily trade. And because Native Americans were deemed to be primitive people, they didn't place too much value on the same things that Europeans did, and they would sell them off for cheap. These goods and bouillon would be brought back to Europe and sold at an immense profit. The French people were told that this investment could not go wrong. John Law found that his plan was working well, and many Frenchmen were more than willing to turn in their silver and gold coins to banks, collect their new paper money, which allowed them to buy investments in the Mississippi Company. They went home with a stock certificate and the dream of getting rich. However, John Law did have trouble finding some Frenchmen who were willing to go to Louisiana and set up those trading posts. Instead, he found that German men across the French border were willing to do the dirty work of sailing across the ocean and engaging in trade with the natives, and he hired them to do that job. And so the ships were off. And when they arrived to Louisiana at the mouth of the Mississippi River, well, unfortunately, once they arrived, all they found was this, swampland, mosquito-infested marshes that offered nothing but malaria. John Law was among the first of the French and German adventurers to sail into the mouth of the Mississippi River, where they disembarked and established a city. John Law attempted to flatter the Duke of Orléans by naming it after him, Nouvelle Orléans, New Orleans. For me, there's something wonderfully ironic about the founding of New Orleans. This is a great all-American city, one of our most unique and multicultural cities. This is a city that gave us the Creoles, the Cajuns, voodoo, jambalaya, and jazz. This is a city that I personally love, and I think it's oh so ironic. Man, this city was founded as a scam. Of course, the Native Americans weren't going to barter with these Europeans. The Choctaw, Biloxi, and Muscogee Indians would just as soon kill the French and German settlers than trade with them. But the Native Americans didn't have to kill them. Within half a year, 80% of the settlers died of yellow fever. The fact that these ships returned to France carrying no fur, no silver, or no gold did not daunt John Law. With paper money and stock certificates in circulation, John Law, he simply lied. He said that the voyage was a success and that the investments were paying off. People cashed in their stock certificates and collected paper money at significantly greater than their initial investments. According to the paper money, they were rich. For the first time in Western civilization, a new word was coined. It's a French word, millionaire. This was exciting. Many of those that had been conservative and hesitated in acquiring paper money and purchasing stock in the Mississippi Company, why, they hesitated no longer. They saw their friends getting rich, and they too wanted a piece of the action. The spring of 1720 was the brief, exciting season of the Mississippi Bubble. Do you see what John Law is doing here? The company isn't working, and he knows this. But everybody has such faith in this new paper currency that they're going to the bank. the bank that he owns, to turn in their own metal coinage to get paper money, which they're using to invest in his company, which in reality is nothing but a flop. Now, John Law probably didn't want the Mississippi Company to be a flop. He probably wished that it was a raging success. He really wanted the natives to trade, and he wanted everything to work smoothly, but it didn't. And when it didn't, he wasn't willing to admit defeat. So he lied. He said it was working and simply had the printing presses print more money to prove it. When this inspired faith and more people invested, he was personally getting richer, while France, unbeknownst to the French, was headed completely towards an economic collapse. Today, we would call this a Ponzi scheme. This is when you get a new set of investors to pay off the earlier investors when a company is failing. Or, as my favorite economic historian Niall Ferguson phrases it, you get a new bunch of suckers to give you money to pay off the old bunch of suckers. Now, obviously, this can't go on forever. The year was 1720, only 4 years after John Law originally came to France and introduced himself to the Duke of Orléans. Reports trickled in that nothing much was being traded in Louisiana, and suspicions aroused that the printers were just printing off worthless money. And these rumors were, of course, all true. A few people started selling off their stock shares and cashing in their paper money for coins. The more people did this, the bank realized that there wasn't enough money in the bank to pay everybody off. And this caused a panic and a rush on the Mississippi Company and the bank. The bank lost all its money, with many people left with absolutely nothing but stock shares and paper money that were now worthless pieces of paper. Now let's pause here. As you listen to a story about a rush to sell stocks, a rush on the banks, you may think, this sounds familiar. Sounds like the 1929 stock market crash in United States history that sparked the Great Depression. And if you're thinking this, well, you're exactly right. It's the exact same thing. In both of these situations, it was human emotion that caused the rush on the banks and the stock market. And this is kind of an important and also difficult concept to understand. It was human emotions that caused the rush on the banks. It started with fear. People were afraid that their stocks were worthless, which was true. They were worthless. However, in both 1720 and in 1929, the people could have just kept their faith in the currency. And if everyone just kept their faith in that paper money and those stocks, then potentially there wouldn't have been a collapse in either 1720 or 1929. But it's hard to imagine a panic not happening, for as soon as somebody gets scared and begins withdrawing their money in a panic, saying it's all worthless, then everybody wants to go and cash in, and there's a rush, because nobody wants to be the last person standing holding worthless pieces of paper, having lost everything. As soon as panic sets in, everybody wants to be the first to get their money out, to be safe, to save themselves, to save their families. So, what was the result of all this? Well, first of all, this is the French response. Check out this great image here. Look in the top right-hand corner. You've got government officials pouring government coinage into this man who's swallowing them, and then notice that he's pooing out paper money and stock certificates to the people. So this gives you a clear sense of what the French think of stock certificates and paper money. They're absolutely worthless. They're poo. John Law, what happened to him? John Law, who owned the bank, took what he wanted before the collapse, left his wife and daughter, and fled to Venice, Italy, where he was able to retire as a wealthy man, a true millionaire. He died 9 years later in 1729. The Duke of Orléans, well, he was able to retreat to Versailles, where he returned to the old mercantilist tradition of not taxing the nobility, but heavily taxing the 97% of the French population. He was upset at the economic collapse, but it didn't affect him too much personally. The city of Nouvelle-Orléans, New Orleans, well, it would continue to grow as an important trading city in the Gulf of Mexico and the Greater Caribbean. It would pass several times between the French and the Spanish until finally, in 1803, Napoleon sold the whole of Louisiana to the United States President Thomas Jefferson, greatly expanding the size of the young United States of America and initiating an era of exploration and manifest destiny in the story of our own country's history. Yay. Go Lewis and Clark. The story of John Law is the story of how, in an unregulated capitalist economy, a company can work the system to its own advantage. The Mississippi Company wasn't regulated because John Law had the full faith and trust of the government, which was the Duke of Orleans, one man in this absolutist regime. He's the most powerful man in France. So once you had his blessing, you'd do whatever you wanted. You might wonder, has this ever happened again in history? You bet. Multiple times. Most recently, the story of the Mississippi Company is nearly parallel to the story of the American energy company Enron in the late 20th and early 21st century. So Enron was founded in Houston, Texas in the middle of the 1980s by a man named Ken Lay. He and his partner Jeffrey Skilling turned it into an incredible investment machine by the end of the 1990s. If you wanted to make money in the late 1990s, you invested in Enron. It was a sure thing. Invest in Enron and you make some good cash. Much like John Law had befriended the Duke of Orleans and gotten his confidence, Ken Lay made significant contributions to the campaign of Republican President George H.W. Bush and befriended his son, then the governor of Texas, George W. Bush. Both of these men would help deregulate the energy industry. Ken Lay also helped to finance the California gubernatorial campaign of the famous actor-turned-politician Arnold Schwarzenegger in the late 1990s, who also helped to deregulate the energy industry in California. Just like John Law lied to the French people about the success of his company, Ken Lay and Jeffrey Skilling were able to hide losses and report significant profits, paying out significant dividends to their investors and to their employees. Enron finally collapsed in December of 2001, but a few months after the September 11th attacks. The company lost $60 billion in investors' money. Jeffrey Skilling, he went to jail for 14 years. Ken Lay was sentenced to go to jail, but died mysteriously of a heart attack on vacation in Vail, Colorado, before he could begin his sentence. The story of Enron and the Mississippi Company are very, very similar. Will a story like this happen again in the future? Most likely, yes. The lesson to be learned here is this. If an investment seems too good to be true, then it probably is. So be very careful, and maybe don't put your entire life savings into a too-good-to-be-true investment. But the future is not what we're studying here. Rather, we're studying the past. What is the long-term significance of John Law? In 1720, due to the Mississippi bubble, the French economy suffered a terrible economic depression. The divide between the aristocracy and the 97% third estate became even more pronounced. John Law established a French society that set into motion the long-term causes of the 1789 French Revolution. That's it for the story of John Law and the Mississippi Bubble. Thanks for watching, Euro Bears. Hope you enjoyed it. Hope you learned something.